Okay, so today we talk about admixture lesions. So these are lesions in the diagnostics that have increased pulmonary vascularity and cyanosis, bidirectional shunts, T lesions, the differential diagnosis. The ones that we make sure we want to mention or know about are
truncus,
transposition, right. So you want to make sure that you know those guys, okay? So detransposition, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, truncus arteriosus, tricuspid atresia without pulmonic stenosis can also give you increased pulmonary blood flow with cyanosis, and then single ventricle also without pulmonary stenosis. If you want tingle ventricle, if you want to remember it as a T lesion. So make sure that you know these three: detransposition, persistent truncus, and total anomalous pulmonary venous return, because that's fair game on the exam. Now, so detransposition, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, truncus arteriosus. The clinical presentation and the physiology will depend on the size and location of shunts. So all of these will have associated ASDs and VSDs and PDAs to various degrees. And that allows for a lot of the bidirectional shunting that occurs. And to have increased pulmonary blood flow, you must also have the absence of pulmonary stenosis. Because if you have pulmonary stenosis, especially if you have a ventricular septal defect, then the physiology will be the same physiology as tetralogy of Fallot. So to have increased pulmonary blood flow, you will not have pulmonary stenosis. For all of these, cardiomegaly is usually proportional to the amount of shunting. If you have small shunting, less cardiomegaly, but the cyanosis will be more severe. Here's an example of transposition with a small shunt, so heart's not that big, but these conditions are associated with worse cyanosis. On the other hand, if we have larger shunts, that tends to mitigate the cyanosis, but usually we have more cardiomegaly and increase in pulmonary blood flow. And what can happen if you have lots of pulmonary blood flow is that you start to develop increased pulmonary vascular resistance. Eisenmenger's physiology, where so you start to develop pulmonary artery hypertension. And what may predominantly be mostly left to right shunting can convert to right to left shunting. Another important thing, whenever you're dealing with lesions that are associated with increased pulmonary blood flow, is that the pulmonary vascular resistance changes. So in the newborn period, the pulmonary vascular resistance is high. So if you have lesions with increased pulmonary blood flow, it may not manifest in the newborn period. But as that pulmonary vascular resistance decreases over the in the beginning there, then the manifestation of the shunt can be more apparent. So we will see then, you will see more increased pulmonary blood flow when the pulmonary vascular resistance decreases, okay? All right, so let's start with this case. So when you're dealing with congenital cardiac disease cases, especially if they're complicated, it's best to learn how to read the studies from the bottom up, okay? So we'll talk about what that means. So we'll start with this guy. So this guy is the IVC, right? Now we know that the IVC will always take you to what chamber?
Right atrium.
Right atrium. So you follow the IVC, and that will take you to the right atrium, okay? So this guy here is the right atrium. Well, what do we think this guy is?
Left atrium.
Yeah, what do we think this guy is?
Hopefully the
right
ventricle.
Right ventricle. Well, what do we think that is then?
Left ventricle.
Left ventricle. Now, already we do see an abnormality right here, right? What do we see here? Yeah, it looks like there's a VSD there, right? And then you want to follow the ventricles to the outflow to see where they lead you. What vessels do the ventricles take you to? How are the ventricles connected? So first, We identify the atria, the morphology of the atria. Then we identify what chambers, what ventricles the respective atria are attached to by their morphology. And then we look at the ventricular outflow to see what vessels the ventricles are attached to, okay? So we've identified the right ventricle and left ventricle, so what can you tell me? What is the, where is the right ventricle going? Where is the left ventricle going?
Right ventricle goes to the aorta, the left goes to the pulmonary.
Right, so now how can you how do you identify that as the aorta? How do you know that, that's the aorta here? So as we follow it up, it takes us to this guy right there. How do you know that's the aorta? Well, one, it takes you to the aortic arch, right? So that's helpful, right? But as you follow it up, you also will notice something else, right? Did you catch that? Yeah, there was a coronary artery coming off of that vessel. Okay, so if you follow it up again, we'll see right ventricle is attached to the aorta. And see the coronary artery. This guy, you follow it, branches into the pulmonary arteries. Now also note the relationship of the aorta to the pulmonary artery. So is the aorta anterior or posterior to the pulmonary artery?
Anterior.
It's anterior, is it to the right or the left?
Rightish.
Yeah, somewhat right. So what condition do we have here? What kind?
D.
D, right. So this is D transposition, right? So detransposition is the, so the first thing is, what is our, detransposition is when you have atrioventricular concordance, the morphologic right atrium is attached to the morphologic right ventricle, morphologic left atrium attached to the morphologic left ventricle, but you have ventricular arterial discordance, which is the definition of transposition, okay? So we have a case then of detransposition. We can follow the aorta down as we've gone through here, and the aorta, there's the pulmonary artery, the aorta goes to the right ventricle, the pulmonary artery goes to the left ventricle. The atria are connected to the correct chambers though, okay? So the most common cyanotic congenital heart disease in the newborn is?
Detransposition.
Right, detransposition, correct. Now the radiographic findings associated with detransposition, we always start with
vascularity.
So pulmonary vascularity is
increased,
and then the classic radiographic finding is egg on a string. Right. So what do we mean by egg on a string? We mean that the mediastinum looks narrowed, the heart looks big, right? And so we've talked about before that narrowing of the mediastinum can be related to the positioning of the vessels, that they may be almost superimposed as opposed to side by side. And the other reason we said that you get narrowing of the mediastinum with congenital heart disease, it could be because of?
Thymic.
Right, thymic atrophy, right, okay. So that can explain the radiographic findings that we have here, okay. Now, the fundamental abnormality in transposition, whenever you hear the word transposition, you translate that term in your mind as
ventricular
arterial discordance. So that means, so whether it's corrected, uncorrected, whatever the position of the aorta is to the pulmonary artery, that part doesn't matter. When you use just the term transposition, it means ventricular arterial concordance. Discordance. So it means that the morphologic right ventricle is attached to the aorta, the morphologic left ventricle is attached to the pulmonary artery. Now, the normal relationship of the pulmonary artery to the aorta is what?
Anterior superior to the left.
Yes, so normally the pulmonary valve actually should be anterior superior and to the left of the aortic valve. When we have detransposition, we will have the aorta anterior and to the right of the pulmonary artery. They might just give you this one picture, right? And from that one picture, you should be able to say the patient's going to have detransposition if you can identify the relationship, an abnormal relationship there of the aorta to the pulmonary artery. So with detransposition, the aorta or the aortic valve will be anterior and to the right of the pulmonic valve. So will the aorta will be in that similar relationship to the pulmonary artery. So with detransposition, or with any transposition, actually, you have ventricular arterial discordance, as we've talked about, as we've gone through.
So, Dr. Malden, in transposition, the aorta is going to be superior into
the valve.
The valve.
Right, but don't worry about that so much. Worry because the aorta is easier to identify.
Right.
So if you can identify the root of the aorta is anterior and to the right of the pulmonary artery, then you probably got a case of detransposition, or that defines detransposition. Right. It's a little more complicated than why we call it DNL, but that has to do with the embryologic cardiac looping. But we'll talk about that later. So, as we said, the aortic root is anterior to the right of the pulmonary artery, comes from the right ventricle. So with detransposition, we have atrioventricular concordance, the right atrium connected to the right ventricle, left atrium connected to the left ventricle, with ventricular arterial discordance, left ventricle connected to the pulmonary artery, right ventricle connected to the aorta. Now, the problem with this, of course, is that you have two completely separate circulations, which would be incompatible with life, unless you had shunting between the circulations to allow the oxygenated blood to get to the systemic circulation. So you have to have shunts. ASD is the most common, but VSDs and PDAs may also be there. You have to have shunts in order to allow oxygenated blood to get to the systemic circulation. Okay? So here's an example with a PDA just there, and an ASD. Here's one with an ASD and a VSD. So I've given you this diagram, but what's important to learn in this diagram here, make sure you know the normal relationship of the pulmonary artery and the aorta, the relationship in detransposition, the relationship in L-transposition, because those are the only images you really need to be able to make the diagnosis. I mean, it's a nice shortcut to be able to make the diagnosis in these cases, okay? So, with detransposition, at least the radiographic appearance varies depending on the amount of shunt and the reactivity of the pulmonary vasculature. If you have a small ASD, then you don't allow the circulations to mix. So that means that there will be severe cyanosis. You're not getting the oxygenated, you're not getting the oxygenated blood where you want it. You need, in this case, in order to allow the circulations to mix, they can do an emergency septostomy until they can do definitive surgery where they can tear up the interatrial septum to allow the communication between the two circulations there through the atrial septum to increase the oxygenation. Okay. So if the ASD is small, the heart, or if the shunts between the two circulations are small, you don't have a lot of cardiomegaly. Pulmonary blood flow may appear normal or decreased, but the cyanosis will be more severe. On the other hand, if you have very large shunts, that tends to mitigate the cyanosis, but at the expense of cardiomegaly, as you're overworking the heart, and also you have a lot of pulmonary blood flow, which can lead to congestive heart failure and can lead to Eisenmenger's. So that can result, whenever you increase the pulmonary blood flow and you have a large amount of it, you can develop pulmonary artery hypertension and eventually Eisenmenger's physiology. That can itself mitigate some of that increased pulmonary blood flow. And also, if there's pulmonary stenosis in that case, that some degree of pulmonary stenosis may also be protective against Eisenmenger's, against developing Eisenmenger's. And so when you have a large amount of left to right shunting, the heart gets big and you have really overflow here in the pulmonary circulation, markedly increased pulmonary. It's when you have the intermediate shunt that the cyanosis may not be as severe and you don't have CHF. And that's where we get this classic appearance of moderate cardiomegaly and that egg on the string appearance. And as we've said, in the neonatal period, because the pulmonary vascular resistance is high, we have to wait for it to drop. That's when we may see, after the pulmonary vascular resistance drops, is when radiographically at least you will see the manifestations of the increased pulmonary blood flow. So the classic appearance, the egg on the string appearance, when we have intermediate shunts of detransposition. Okay. So, egg on a string, narrow mediastinum. Remember, start with the pulmonary blood flow, increased pulmonary blood flow, cyanosis, narrow mediastinum, and some degree of cardiomegaly. So, the right ventricle here is connected to the aorta, which is usually anterior to the pulmonary arteries. There's the aorta connected to the right ventricle. The left ventricle is connected to the pulmonary artery, which usually winds up posterior to the aorta, coming from the left ventricle. And here's a nice view where you can see the aorta and the pulmonary artery. You can see that relationship on a lateral image. You can see that the aorta there is anterior to the pulmonary artery. So this is very important. Make sure that you can recognize the normal relationship, pulmonary artery anterior to the left of the aorta, that's normal. If we see the aorta anterior to the right of the pulmonary artery, then we suspect that we have detransposition. Okay. All right, so we've done detransposition. So let's move on to the next case. So we've labeled everything for you. So tell me if you can come up with what we think is going on here. Well, is there one vessel or two separate vessels there?
Separate.
Two separate vessels. So is that truncus?
No,
it's not truncus. Actually, you have two separate valves. You have two separate valves. There's a pulmonic valve and an aortic valve. So it's not truncus.
Well, the aorta is anterior to the right of the pulmonary artery, so
yep.
Detransposition.
So it does look like there's some at least malposition of the pulmonary arteries, but what chambers are these vessels coming from?
Well, it's hard to say because there's this huge VSD, so maybe it's like a.
Well, what is this guy?
Right,
and where does it take you?
The pulmonary artery.
So, what is this guy? And it takes you also to the aorta, right? So this is called?
Single ventricle?
No, it's not single ventricle. There is a left ventricle there.
Double.
This is double outlet right ventricle. So you can see that kind of how it's related to transposition, right? So double outlet right ventricle is considered a partial transposition. So this is double outlet right ventricle. When both vessels originate from the right ventricle, or at least greater than 50% of both vessels originate from the right ventricle. So it's considered a partial form of transposition where more than 50% of both vessels originate from the right ventricle. So you have to have a VSD, right? Because there's no place for the blood to go from the left ventricle. So it has to go across the VSD and then out to the other side. So the physiology is determined by the location of the VSD and whether or not there's associated pulmonic stenosis. If there is pulmonic stenosis with double outlet right ventricle, again, the physiology will resemble tetralogy of Fallot, where we will have cyanosis with decreased pulmonary blood flow. And it turns out that 75% of cases of double outlet right ventricle will have pulmonic stenosis. Right? And in this diagram, we also show you the relationship there of type 1 and type 2. The difference between double outlet right ventricle type 1 and double outlet ventricle type 2. So which one is worse? So can anybody tell me the difference, even in virtual land, between double outlet right ventricle type 1 and type 2? Well, type 1 is when the ventricular septal defect takes you to the aorta, which is a good thing, because then we have the blood flow from the left ventricle going through the VSD and directed towards the aorta, which is where you want the blood from the left ventricle to go. You want it to go to the aorta. So that tends to make cyanosis milder. So clinically and radiographically, that can resemble a large VSD with increased pulmonary blood flow, especially if there is no pulmonic stenosis. And this may have a widened vascular pedicle as the aorta and the pulmonary artery tend to be more side by side. Type 2 is worse. This is also called tacit Bing complex. So here, the ventricular septal defect takes you to the pulmonary artery. So the left ventricle, the blood from there goes across the VSD, but goes to the pulmonary artery. And if blood from the left ventricle goes to the pulmonary artery, physiologically, that resembles transposition. Okay? And then the right ventricular blood goes to the aorta. So here the cyanosis is going to be worse. So this can resemble clinically and radiographically, resemble more detransposition. But these patients will have worse cyanosis. And again, here the vascular pedicle, at least on the x-ray, may appear widened because the vessels tend to be more side by side. Now, there are other types too, but these two are the most important types to know. Type 1 makes up about 60%, type 2 makes up about 30%. And the physiology is determined by the location of the ventricular septal defect. So if the ventricular septal defect is far away from the great vessels, then that's an uncommitted ventricular septal defect. If the ventricular septal defect is close, it's right underneath both vessels, then it's a doubly, that's considered a doubly committed ventricular septal defect. But these two are the ones that are most common, type 1 and type 2. And here are some illustrations. So type 1, when we have a subaortic VSD, so from the left ventricle, it goes across the VSD into the aorta. Type 2, if we have a subtumonic VSD, so the blood from the left ventricle goes across the VSD into the pulmonary artery. So this is worse, of course. This resembles transposition physiologically. Type 3, uncommitted, meaning the VSD is far away from the outward vessels. And type 4, doubly committed, meaning the VSD is so close to both vessels that the blood can go to either vessel. Now, in terms of the physiology, a lot of it depends on whether or not, of course, the location of the VSD and whether or not there's pulmonic stenosis. As you said, if there is pulmonic stenosis and you have a subaortic VSD, it can resemble tetralogy of flow. With a subpulmonic VSD, we've said without pulmonic stenosis, it will resemble transposition in terms of the physiology. Subaortic VSD, as we said, without pulmonic stenosis, that physiologically can resemble a VSD. And there is another variant where you can have a very small left ventricle, a hypoplastic left ventricle, and then the right ventricle is the only really functioning ventricle, and physiologically that can resemble single ventricle. Right? But the ones to know a little bit something about is type 1 and type 2. Okay? So type 1, subaortic VSD, physiologically can resemble a VSD. Type 2, subpulmonic VSD, can resemble transposition. Assuming you don't have pulmonic stenosis, both of these will give you increased pulmonary blood flow and some degree of cyanosis. The cyanosis, of course, will be worse with subpulmonic VSD. All right? So what do you want to know about? What do you need to know? The aorta and the pulmonary artery both arise from the vent, from the right ventricle. You have to have a ventricular septal defect because the blood from the left ventricle has got to go somewhere, so that goes across the VSD and into the right side. And then another interesting thing is you'll have two infundibuli. Remember, we talked about the outflow tract of the right ventricle. Normally, that outflow tract takes you to pulmonary artery. That's a muscular outflow tract. So if you look at follow the pulmonary artery down, there's a myocardium there that is in the right ventricle that connects you there, that separates the inflow and the outflow valve. So you often can find two infundibuli, one beneath each vessel. So there'll be one beneath the pulmonary artery and one beneath the aorta when you have double outward right ventricle. Okay. All right, so let's discuss this case. So again, when we're dealing with complex congenital heart disease, we like to start with this guy, which is the
IVC,
because that's going to take us to
right atrium.
Now, another nice way you can identify that as the right atrium is this guy. What is this guy?
Coronary
sinus. So here, this guy over here is left atrium, right? So this guy over here, we suspect, will be
right ventricle.
Right ventricle, this guy. Already we can see an abnormality here. Do you see?
It's
a big ASD. Yeah, it looks like there's a big ASD, right? And now, there's another abnormality here. Do you see?
VSD.
VSD, right, there's a VSD too. So we've identified the atria, we've identified the ventricles. Now we want to see the connections of these chambers. You know, how are these chambers connected? We've said that this guy is, and this guy, okay? So now we follow those guys and see where they go. Well, let's see. Let's take a look.
It looks like a huge PA or something.
So there's our VSD. And then we get to this. See that big guy? And then what happens?
Then it splits off to the pulmonary artery and aorta.
Right. What do we call that?
Truncus arteriosus.
Yeah, so this is truncus arteriosus. So there's a large VSD, and on top of that large VSD, there's this one large vessel, and from that vessel, you get then the pulmonary artery, the aorta and the pulmonary artery.
Right.
So here is the large VSD here, and on top of the VSD, receiving blood from both ventricles, you have this large common vessel, and then you can see the pulmonary arteries branching off of that, and then that goes on to give you up here the aorta and the branchiosus from the aorta. So that then is truncus arteriosus. So there's your truncus coming down here. Here's our truncus down here. There's the pulmonary arteries coming off. And then that comes down and sits on top of a large ventricular septal defect. Okay. And then here I think we have everything labeled for you. There's the aorta. Arteries back there, there's our truncus, and there's your big VSD. Right? And a big ASD also in this case. Right? So common vessel sitting on top of a large VSD, there's one outlet valve. Okay, this one outlet valve takes you to this common vessel, and then that vessel then, from there you get the aorta and the pulmonary artery. So persistent truncus, a single heart from a single trunk from the heart supplies the pulmonary, systemic, and coronary circulations. And this is where all of the blood mixes between the left and the right circulations. If there's no pulmonic stenosis, you tend to get more left to right shunting because of the lower pulmonary vascular resistance. The valves of the truncus itself can have anywhere between 2 and 6 cusps, usually 3. But if it's less than 3 or greater than 3, then it may be incompetent, but most commonly it is tricuspid. Other anomalies associated with truncus, this you do need to know, right aortic arch, up to 30 to 40% of cases, interrupted aortic arch, up to 20% of cases. So those associations with truncus you do need to be familiar with. There's a Collett Edwards classification of the different types of truncus. Type 1 is when the main pulmonary artery comes off the truncus. Type 2 is when the right and left pulmonary arteries come off the posterior aspect of the truncus. Type 3 is when the right and left pulmonary arteries come off the side of the truncus. In their original paper, they describe a type 4 where the pulmonary arteries here come off the descending thoracic aorta, but it turns out they were wrong, that this represents a case of pulmonary atresia, not really truncus, and these are major aortopulmonary collateral arteries, not really true pulmonary arteries. So they actually published a retraction paper. So this has been, this type 4 then, has been known as pseudotruncus. It's not a true truncus, it's really it's really pulmonary atresia with collateral vessels that are supplying the pulmonary circulation. But this is the Collett Edwards classification. I mean, a better classification is the von Prague classification. So I've given you this also. So the type 1 is the same, where you have a main pulmonary artery coming off the truncus. Type 2, the pulmonary arteries can come off the side or the back of the truncus. And there's a type 3 where the left pulmonary artery can actually come off the PDA. And here, because as we said, up to 20% of truncus arteriosus can be associated with interrupted aortic arch, type 4 in this classification is truncus with interrupted aortic arch. Right. So I've given you this diagram showing you the different types, the classification there of truncus. I think if you can recognize type 1 and type 2, you'll be fine. Okay, but so the pulmonary artery and the aorta come off this common vessel, the truncus arteriosus. So we will have increased pulmonary blood flow in up to 40% of cases. You can have a right aortic arch. We will have cardiomegaly. On the radiograph in type 1, there will be a main pulmonary artery, right? Remember, type 1 is a main pulmonary artery, so that will appear enlarged. Type 2 and type 3, though, the Collett Edwards classification, there is no main pulmonary artery. There's just the right and left. So you won't see an enlarged main pulmonary artery on the chest radiograph. And it can be asymmetric, the pulmonary blood flow, because you can also have stenosis at the origin of the pulmonary arteries. Right? So here we have big pulmonary arteries. Notice the right aortic arch. Here is our truncus on the MR, and you can see the pulmonary artery coming off the truncus arteriosus and then goes on to form the aorta. So that's type 1. So another example, there's a VSD. On top of the VSD, you have the truncus vessel here, and then from that vessel, you get aorta and we get pulmonary artery. On the radiograph for type 2 or type 3, there is no enlarged main pulmonary artery segment because there is no main pulmonary artery. You will see increased pulmonary blood flow because the right and left pulmonary arteries come off the truncus. Now make sure that you can differentiate this from aortopulmonary window, okay? So aortopulmonary, don't confuse the two. Aortopulmonary window, you have a separate aorta and a pulmonary artery, and they are connected at the level of the ascending aorta. But they have separate valves. They're two separate vessels with two separate valves. The truncus arteriosus has one outlet valve, okay, with it, that leads you to this one vessel. Okay, so let's move on to our next case. So you guys examine this and tell me what you think. Okay, so this vessel is the, you said the right pulmonary artery, and you can see it here too, and it's coming off the aorta. This guy you think is the left pulmonary artery, and it's coming off the main main pulmonary artery there. Okay, so what is this called? What do we call this? Anybody know? So when you have one pulmonary artery coming off the aorta and the other one coming off, you know, the pulmonary artery where it's supposed to come off, this is called hemitruncus, right? Usually the right pulmonary artery comes off the ascending aorta while the left pulmonary artery comes off the right ventricle. So this does, of course, results in a left to right shunt, right? You have the pulmonary artery coming off the aorta. You have separate aortic and pulmonic valves. You can have stenosis at either the right or the left pulmonary artery at the origin, but it's called hemitruncus. It's kind of half a truncus, right? So only one pulmonary artery comes off the aorta as opposed to both. So the lung supplied by the right ventricle is normal vasculature. The lung supplied by the aorta can have aneurysmal branches because of that high pressure from the aorta. So you can have a dilated ascending aorta, right-sided arch in 20 to 30% of cases. All right, so here we have a case of increased pulmonary blood flow and cyanosis. We look at the chest radiograph. We should be able to suggest something. What will we suggest? Not partial anomalous. So total anomalous pulmonary venous return, right? What sign is demonstrated here? Yes, the snowman sign. So the snowman sign is associated with total anomalous pulmonary venous return type 1, yes. So, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, when the pulmonary veins do not connect to the left atrium, instead they wind up returning to the right atrium. So the right atrium becomes the common collecting chamber where all of the blood mixes. That's where we get our admixture. And then from here, it has to go into through an ASD into the left atrium. From there, it can get into the left ventricle, all right? So this total anomalous pulmonary venous return can be associated with asplenia. 75% of patients with asplenia have total anomalous pulmonary venous return. So that is an association that you guys need to be familiar with. The different types of total anomalous pulmonary venous return, who can tell me? Type 1 is supercardiac. Type 2? Cardiac, right? Usually return to the type 2, it goes to the coronary sinus, right? Type 3? Infracardiac, right. So the common pulmonary vein goes below the diaphragm, can drain to the portal vein or to the IVC, many times to the portal vein. And type 4 is any combination of these. Okay. So, but the ones to be familiar with, I mean, type 1 and type 3, those come up on exams a lot. So you need to be familiar with that. So supracardiac, cardiac, infracardiac, or infradiaphragmatic, right? But type 1 and type 3, you have to know those for your exams. So with total anomalous pulmonary venous return type 1, the pulmonary veins usually drain to this common vein, the vertical vein, which drains to the brachiocephalic vein, which drains to the superior vena cava. And it's all these dilated vessels here in the superior mediastinum. That's what gives you the head of the snowman. The big heart gives you the rest of the snowman. So it will have increased pulmonary venous return, and you'll have the snowman sign usually with anomalous pulmonary venous connection type 1. Type 2, it can drain to a dilated coronary sinus. And type 3, the drainage goes below the diaphragm, many times to the portal vein. And so what's significant about this is that this is associated with obstruction of the pulmonary venous drainage here, which results in pulmonary venous hypertension, pulmonary edema failure. So this type is associated with failure, okay? So if we don't have obstruction of the pulmonary veins, you can have cardiomegaly, increased pulmonary blood flow, as you said, the snowman sign with type 1 total anomalous pulmonary venous return, right? So you want to recognize the snowman sign of total anomalous pulmonary venous return. So it's going to be type 1. So we said the snowman, vertical vein, brachiocephalic vein, superior vena cava, that's what gives you the snowman here, okay? So here it is on an angio, pulmonary veins, vertical vein, left brachiocephalic vein, superior vena cava, that makes up the snowman. And here it is on CT, vertical vein, brachiocephalic vein, superior vena cava, and to really drive the point home, we'll give you some volume rendering here to show you the pulmonary veins here, going to the vertical vein, brachiocephalic vein, superior vena cava. This is what gives you the snowman radiographically when we have type 1, total anomalous pulmonary venous return. Type 2 drains to a coronary sinus, which is usually dilated. Here you see an indentation here on the esophagus because of this dilated coronary sinus. And then here it is on the CT. You can see these pulmonary veins here. They're draining to this dilated coronary sinus there, okay? So that's type 2, cardiac return to the coronary sinus. If I tell you that this patient has cyanosis with pulmonary edema, notice that the heart size is normal. So if we have this picture of normal heart size with failure and cyanosis, what are we supposed to think of? And this comes up year after year on the exam. They do ask about this. What? Yeah, this is type 3 total anomalous pulmonary venous return. So because the pulmonary vein is obstructed, you get pulmonary edema, but because all of this is occurring before you get to the heart, you don't have cardiomegaly. So you have pulmonary edema without cardiomegaly, and of course, these patients will be cyanotic. So this is type 3 total anomalous pulmonary venous return. Here, the common pulmonary vein drains down to, here it's draining to the portal vein, gets obstructed, and we wind up with pulmonary edema with normal heart size. So, cyanosis, normal heart size, pulmonary edema, type 3, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, where it's draining below the diaphragm, okay? So, we've said that the findings on the chest x-ray can sometimes mimic meconium aspiration, etc. But cyanosis, pulmonary edema, normal heart size, first week of life, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, type 3. So that's what you want to know about. So here are the veins coming down, going below, and here you can actually see obstruction here as they're going down below the diaphragm, okay? Here they're going to the portal vein, and you can see also if the venous drainage has to go through the portal system, there also can be obstructed because you have high vascular resistance there through the hepatic sinusoids. All right, so let's talk about this case next. So this guy is left atrium, this guy is right atrium. What's happening after that? So, how many ventricles do you see?
One.
So, what do you think this is called?
Single ventricle.
Yeah, so this is single ventricle. And by the way, these guys over here, do you know what vessel this is? Nope. This one's pulmonary artery. This is aorta. Notice the relationship of the aorta to the pulmonary artery here. Okay. It's to the left of the pulmonary artery. We'll come back to that, right? So this is single ventricle, right? So single ventricle or double inlet ventricle where both atria empty into one ventricle, which is really the only functioning ventricle. Most are single ventricle of the left ventricular type. So the morphology resembles the left ventricle. The right ventricle is actually underdeveloped and small and sits out here underneath the aorta. And the aorta tends to be to the left of the pulmonary artery. So aorta from this rudimentary right ventricle to the left of the pulmonary artery. So this is an L transposition. So single ventricle of the left ventricular type is associated with L transposition. What happens is that you have this opening, which is called the bulbo ventricular foramen, that connects this single ventricle to this area over here, to that right ventricle, that rudimentary right ventricle there. And then from there, the blood can get into the aorta. And as we've said, there's an L transposition. The aorta here is to the left of the pulmonary artery and coming off that rudimentary right ventricle. So both atrial ventricular valves connect to the single ventricle, so it's a double inlet left ventricle. The blood mixes in here, and then from the right atrium to the single ventricle, it can be directed towards the pulmonary artery. From the left atrium, the blood tends to be directed towards the bulbo ventricular foramen. From there, it gets into the right ventricle here and then into the aorta. Without pulmonic stenosis, usually mild cyanosis with excessive pulmonary blood flow, but with pulmonic stenosis, it will resemble, the physiology resembles tetralogy of Fallot. So if we go back to our image here, right? So there's the bulbo ventricular foramen here. This little guy over here is the rudimentary right ventricle. That is attached to the aorta, and the pulmonary artery, here's a little bit of pulmonic stenosis here, is attached to this single ventricle, to the single ventricle of the left ventricular type. So there is an L transposition. So single ventricle of the left ventricular type is the most common form of single ventricle that we will see. Right? There's a right ventricular type also, but it's the other one.
What was that dark line across the right ventricle and the aorta?
Where is it?
Everyone away on the MR. Yeah, that like vertical dark band basically.
This?
No, between the little right ventricle and the aorta.
Over here?
Yeah, like
that. That's myocardium. We're a little bit. No, we're not
across the valve like that, kind of heading
up here.
Like just going straight up and down across the aorta valve. That thing.
This?
No, really not sure. Dark vertical band. Like close.
Vertical band.
Right. Yeah, on the right, it's like spanning across the valve.
I don't really see. This, there's signal here from pulmonic stenosis.
This guy.
Oh, I think we're just partial volume averaging some myocardium or something else on the image there, right? Because this is shown to demonstrate the relationship here of the pulmonary artery to the ventricle and the aorta. Okay. All right. So we've gone through that. So we said that most is the single ventricle of the left ventricular type. And because the aorta can be to the left of the pulmonary artery, sometimes you will have this appearance on the chest radiograph. This represents the aorta there on the left side of the pulmonary artery, which you can see with L transposition, that finding in the chest radiograph. Okay? And so here it is on angio. You can see the aorta here to the left of the pulmonary artery. So there's an L transposition in that particular case. Okay, so here we follow the IVC, right? And it takes you to?
Right atrium.
This guy is?
Left atrium.
Left atrium. That takes you to?
Left ventricle,
right? And then you see the aorta there. So what happens?
There's a moderator band in the left ventricle.
No, not quite. No, notice the relationship of the aorta to the pulmonary artery, though, right? So where's the right ventricle? Do we see the right ventricle here?
No, I don't see.
What if I tell you that little guy, that little guy there is the right ventricle? So, well, we have that little guy as the right ventricle, right? And that little guy is connected to the right. So there is a transposition, right? But why is the right ventricle so small? Now, remember you mentioned single ventricle. For single ventricle, you want to see both of the atrioventricular valves emptying into the single ventricle. So we do see the left atrioventricular valve going into that ventricle, going into that left ventricle. But what about the right atrioventricular valve? Where is it? See? We don't see it at all, right? So that means we have, as you said, what do we have? Tricuspid atresia, right. There's tricuspid atresia. We don't see the right atrioventricular valve. Right? So this is a case of tricuspid atresia with transposition in this case, right? There, the arrow's pointing to the absence or soft tissue or fat where the tricuspid valve is supposed to be. So we're not able to identify the tricuspid valve, and that explains why the right ventricle is so small. Okay? So tricuspid atresia, we have an atretic tricuspid valve. The right ventricle is usually small, hypoplastic. There has to be an ASD because that's the only place the blood can go from the right atrium. It has to go across the atrial septum into the left atrium and then into the left ventricle. So the blood flow is from the right atrium through the ASD to the left atrium, left ventricle, and from there it goes across the VSD and then to the right ventricle. So that's the path of blood flow when we have tricuspid atresia. And in this case, we have tricuspid atresia with transposition, as that very small right ventricle is connected to the aorta, and the left ventricle in this case was connected to the pulmonary artery. Okay. Now, as we said, the right ventricle tends to be small. You may have transposition, you may have pulmonic stenosis. The admixture, everything kind of mixes together in the left atrium. The blood flow through the lungs will occur because of through a VSD. And also a PDA would help. Okay? If there is no pulmonic stenosis, the pulmonary blood flow will be increased. With pulmonic stenosis, of course, the pulmonary blood flow will be decreased. Now, I've given you all of this too, the different varieties depending on your combinations of transposition and pulmonic stenosis. So you don't have to know that in any great detail, but know that these two are the most common flavors of tricuspid atresia. Tricuspid atresia without transposition is usually associated with pulmonic stenosis, usually with a small VSD. So these patients will have cyanosis with decreased blood flow. Transposition without pulmonic stenosis, this tends to have a large VSD. So these patients will have cyanosis with increased pulmonary blood flow, especially if you have transposition, right, and no pulmonic stenosis because the pulmonary artery is attached to the left ventricle. So you will have increased pulmonary blood flow. So increased pulmonary blood flow and cyanosis. So if we have tricuspid atresia without transposition, no pulmonic stenosis, basically if you don't have pulmonic stenosis and a large VSD, you will have increased pulmonary blood flow. Okay. Right atrial border tends to be flattened, especially because the right atrium is not so big. And then tricuspid atresia with transposition, no pulmonic stenosis, large VSD, again, that will also give you increased pulmonary blood flow. This little bump over here is kind of interesting. That can be from what's called juxtaposed right atrial appendage. The right atrial appendage kind of forms on the other side, and that can give you that little bump on a chest x-ray. That's mildly interesting. Okay. But the important thing to recognize it, you look for the tricuspid valve. Tip off, usually the right ventricle is small. When you look for the tricuspid valve, you don't see it. You may see fat where the tricuspid valve should be. So your inability to identify the tricuspid valve is your clue that you're probably dealing with a case of tricuspid atresia. Here's another example, tricuspid atresia. In this case, why is the right ventricle not so small? Right ventricle is not small in this case. Why? The size of the chamber in embryology is determined by the amount of blood that goes through it. Yeah, there's a large VSD, right? So that allows enough blood to go through that right ventricle so it doesn't get very small there. Okay. Another interesting finding, left axis deviation on EKG, because the right ventricles tend to be smaller in these patients. Okay. So the things to remember, the most common of these admixture lesions, detransposition, persistent truncus, and total anomalous pulmonary venous return. Detransposition, most common cyanotic congenital heart disease in infants, gives you the egg on a string appearance on the chest radiograph. Persistent truncus has a high association with right aortic arch. For total anomalous pulmonary venous return, we want to remember the snowman appearance on the plain film for type 1. And if we have CHF with normal heart size, we want to think of type 3 total anomalous pulmonary venous return, especially when there is cyanosis. So the egg on a string appearance is the classic plain film appearance for detransposition. That's our egg on a string. And the fundamental problem with detransposition is ventricular arterial discordance. The aorta will usually be found anterior and to the right of the pulmonary artery. Truncus arteriosus, there's a truncal valve above a ventricular septal defect that then divides into the aorta and the pulmonary artery. This has a high association with right aortic arch. Total anomalous pulmonary venous return, the snowman sign. And type 1 is the type that is associated with the snowman sign. Type 3, normal heart size with failure or pulmonary edema, is type 3, total anomalous pulmonary venous return, infradiaphragmatic pulmonary venous return. And here we can see the veins coming below the diaphragm draining into the portal vein. And these are the less common admixture lesions, but those were the major points that we need to bear in mind for this topic.